Thank you, Ramu. And thank you, everyone, for giving me this opportunity. Let me warn you that I've served in the police for 17 years. I was the Bihar cadre, and therefore probably realized that it is better to teach about policing than doing it. So I've been teaching for the last 20 years. I'm a professor of criminal justice at Indiana University. And having become a professor of criminal I'm quite used to talking. And I always close my classroom so that my students cannot escape. I will please request that keep those doors locked. Relax, sit down. I have lots to talk. We have a really big problem. And I'm not going to go into the dimensions about it. It has been talked about. I also want to add that it is not only the actual incidents about which we have been talking about, simply the fact that we have this problem also invokes a lot of fear. So there's a much, much wider fear about crimes against women, which far surpasses the actual incidents that are happening. Unfortunate part is that we have been talking about it endlessly for many, many years in many, many forums, and this feeling of helplessness still persists. But we have no idea what really we should be doing, how to deal about it, and I find it encouraging that we always keep on saying that we need to do this, we need to do that. Somehow it is always that somebody else should be doing it. And that cycle just keeps on going about it. Root causes have been talked about. That we need to change attitude, we need to change our society and the social thinkings, and we need to essentially transform the society. Absolutely, you know, there's absolutely no question about it. But that's obviously a very, very long-term process. Nobody knows how to do that. And how it and what time frame can it be done? What we are facing is an immediate problem. We have an immediate problem, and the immediate problem is that whether I should let my daughter come to back to Bangalore. She spent about a year and a half studying here in National Law School, doing some research, and every day we had to call from the US to make sure that she was safely getting onto the bus, and then she got down, and on and on. So that is the, you know, urgency. Trying to therefore, you know, talk about that we need to sort of move towards solving the root problem is necessary, but clearly we need something else to be done, which is the same argument that we are also making, that policing cannot be done properly because politicians are controlling it. What we all know very well is policing is totally political. Policing is a political process. And therefore, it cannot be diverse from political control. Nowhere it ever in the world it has been happened. Mechanisms have been developed through which you try and regulate or control some of the interference that may be happening. But policing remains completely a political process. And therefore, what we need is a new approach. My research is completely based, sort of focused upon policing in India. And I've been thinking deeply and deeply about it, and I want to share some of my thoughts, and hope we can proceed along that particular process. What I want to suggest is that as an immediate step, we should think what the criminology has been doing and what the criminology has been developing and dealing with these particular problems. Criminology, as we all know, is a study of crime, and we ask the first basic question, what is crime? And as good criminologists, we have failed to give the answer, and we intend not to give the answer because then we will go out of business. So what is crime is largely sort of restricted as act that is prohibited in law, which raises many, many questions, who makes the law and why this particular act and why not that other kind of act, how it is made, and so on and so forth. So one branch of criminology clearly deals with these particular larger questions. The other question that as criminologists we ask is why people commit crime. We also know that in the same disorganized neighborhood and family setting, there is a saint and there is a sinner. So So what is really happening, why somebody commits crime, is also one particular line of question that has been pursued for a very long period of time, but we have no clear answer for that. What we do know, and I'll be talking a little about it, is the kind of a person who may end up committing those kind of an act, but then again the knowledge is very, very restricted. And therefore, criminologists have thought about it, that if we need to think about immediate steps and what is the most effective one. One particular line of criminology has worked in this particular direction and has taken a very practical view, which is what I want to say. What we talk about is that crime has four dimensions. One is the law. You need to have a definition of criminal behavior in law, otherwise it is not a crime. The other one is an offender. Somebody has to commit a crime. Somebody has to do that kind of a deviant act. And therefore, we are focused upon who this particular offender is. There is now a lot of research which has sort of established the basic characteristics and profile of an offender. We have gone back to early stages and also know that from a very early childhood, in certain kind of circumstances, a child learns to be deviant, and that deviant slowly evolves and gets him into big trouble later on, which is a kind of a controversial line of thought, because it seems to presume that there is something genetic about it. It is not really genetic, but there is something to do with biochemistry, of how somebody cannot control his or her emotions or gets angry very quickly and on, so that's a different line of inquiry we're talking about. But we have a very good profile that almost 95 to 98% of the crimes anywhere in the world, for all the historical records we have, are committed by male between the ages of about 14, 15 to about 30, 35. Beyond that period, almost every criminal then slowly starts getting out of it. And I think we suspect that the reason is that finally, not that he sees reason, but he gets into a family commitment where then he slowly changes his or her ways. The third dimension is the victim. And surprisingly, the research suggests that victim and offender share very similar characteristics. So there's some food for thought. What I want to emphasize is that this is largely based upon Western research, and we need to do similar research out here, because I have a very clear idea that the victim and offender profile are going to be much different out here. But we have no really research finding to support that contention. It is the fourth dimension where something really seems possible, and which is what I want to emphasize. All the three dimensions of law, offender, and victim must interact at some place and time. There is a geography of crime where a crime takes place. It could be a road, it could be a home, it could be a workplace, it could be some transit place, but there is a specific time, there is a specific place in which that particular crime is taking place. Focus upon that helps us, because that particular place and time is something which is malleable. We can do something with that place, we can do something with that time to try and therefore minimize the possibility of a criminal acting in that occurring in that particular place and time. We, based upon this particular inquiry, we also know that if you look into this place and time, then what we find is that this is not randomly distributed. There is a very specific pattern in every kind of a crime that you find. There are some places where there's more crime, there's some places where there's less crime, and there are different time periods also associated with that. If crime is not randomly distributed, then the firm conclusion is that the offender is a rational person. Offender is looking for opportunities, and it is the opportunities that create that particular situation where a vulnerable victim also interacts with that offender in that particular place and time, and in the absence of a guardian, a possibility of crime becomes up. Again, because we don't know why people commit crime, even if there's an opportunity, fortunately, many, many will not commit a crime, but there are one or two who will commit a crime. So the focus upon the geography of crime is something which is very promising, and which is what I think will help us try and address many of the issues that we have been talking about. Let me quickly mentioned, there are three areas I want us to focus upon. And I'm going to be sort of pointing towards the stakeholders. We'll talk first about the police, a little about the government officials who are there, and then of course the larger civil society that we have. For the police, what I want to emphasize is that forget politics. Again, political reform, etc., is much needed, obviously, but that really cannot be the sole criteria. Sir, I just want to make one small point, which I have made before also before you, is that there was a time period in our country in the 50s when we had very good politicians, absolutely upright. We had a situation where the IG was controlling all transfer and posting of even superintendents of offices. There was not even an iota of political interference. But still, it was a time when citizens were scared to go to the police station. Indeed, one of my IG was used to mention that he had served during the British period, that if a constable would keep his cap somewhere, then citizens would not sort of even hover around that area for miles apart. So even when everything what we are sort of looking for was there, situation wasn't really very different. In fact, today I'm very happy that we have somebody who wants to take a graduate student or some intern to the police station just to sit down and observe and what's going on. I hope the DG and the commissioner would really take up this issue. We should highlight that police station is also a place where, you know, somebody is most welcome to just come and visit. It's a very sea change from what had been happening before. If we really want to do something from within the police department, then I suggest that data and research is something that we really need to focus upon. Research cannot happen without data, and data is something which the police department controls and has ample of it. You make it so difficult to get data that even with all my friendship and all, you know, it becomes very difficult to get that data. So the data is not, I do know that, we'll keep it in mind. I will permit somebody who's really desperate to go that please you may go ahead, but I will try and finish it very quickly. It is not only the FIR data that we should be really focusing upon. FIR is just one part of the police action related to crime whose record keeping is so problematic. Now we have a system where police gets information about crime or problems to the citizens in ample measures. There is the 100 call data, which is at least 2,300-400 times more voluminous than the FIR. There are complaints that are lodged with every police officer, from the constable to the DGP. Every citizen goes with a chit, a small complaint. Fortunately, all of these are very well documented. They're all available. We don't never destroy them. This particular data set, if you analyze and you find that this is rich in information, and this can be obviously used for developing and improving your processes. Why this is important is that we need to think about that police is not really a crime fighter unit. Crime fighting is one of the things that we do. Police is largely problem solvers. We are solving all kinds of problems that the citizen think the police can help in any way. And if you were to really look into the police records, even in police station records, forget the FIR, you will find that the citizens are coming to the police for so many different type of problems that somehow or the other, we never acknowledge that we are trying to deal with them, and our focus is only limited to FIR. If you think police as a problem solver, then specific type of crime is also one of the problems that we need to solve, and therefore we can develop some strategies behind it. This particular data is, I'm not going to waste any time. We have modern technologies, we have analytics, we have all kinds of now software and algorithms that can help us unravel those particular patterns and suggest ways in which we can try and minimize those particular opportunities. What is needed is within the police department a will that you want your policing to be data-driven. Unfortunately, the commissioner and the DGP are not here, but they should have one of the best officers dealing with data, the SCRB, or the people who keep the record keeping. This is something within them, and no politician is ever going to ask you, why are you trying to keep this data, or why you're not, you know, what is happening about data, because they have no interest in it. that becomes your module, the vehicle for particular transformation of the organization. Because once you have all the data and all the analytics, then it becomes very difficult for anybody to deny that particular result that you have. Secondly, to some of the officials that we have from the state government, I'm glad that there are a lot of policies that are being making upon the empowerment. We need to think widely, and as rightly suggested, about empowerment of women, and many policies have to be developed about it. I want to focus a little about the civil society that we have and all the NGOs that we have. I see your role as one of holding all the other two accountable and assessing how they are doing. This has to be done at the local level. Fine, we can talk about broader policies, but why is it that your police station is not functioning properly? If the police station doesn't take care, if the DCP doesn't listen, still in a democratic society, you should be able to work in a manner that you begin to hold them and sort of force them to begin to be accountable to you. This is grassroots democracy. This is what is needed. Somebody mentioning about the borough that is, you know, example in England, it's called neighborhood policing. And that has been very effective. If the citizens are empowered a little to determine how policing should be done in the area, then you find that that happens very well. And that will only happen if the citizens begin to really vociferously demand about that. So finally, in terms of the stakeholders, there's a lot that I have learned today, and what we are intending is to sort of expand it and go in other places and begin to sort of develop this learning process. I hope everybody has given their names and addresses, because we will be pursuing, I'm certainly going to be pursuing you. I need lots to hear from you, and we want you to please document in more depth what you have said today, because that is what we want to compile and develop into a way in which we can learn, because we have absolutely no clear-cut prototype which can tell us what needs to be done. We need to learn, experiment, fail, and then learn again. Thank you so much.